So good morning everyone. Today I will start with the chapter transforms. So basically I will be just giving you the overview. We are not having this in the course, but since many of you are from different backgrounds, I thought to just give an overview of the transforms so that it makes it easy for you when we get into the digital systems and how we work for what you call, how to design the filters and all these things, right? Among this, I will cover Fourier series, Fourier transform, discrete time Fourier series, discrete time Fourier transform, discrete Fourier transform. We'll be covering this topic, this discrete Fourier transform in details. Then Laplace transform. Over here we will see what is Laplace transform, and then how it is useful in the generation or in the designing of the analog systems. Okay, because Laplace transform, it is basically used for the analysis of the analog systems. Okay, and to have a better understanding for the designing of the digital systems, we should know what are the what are the aspects in the analog systems, because we take the principles from there and then we apply those in the digital domain. And lastly, we will be discussing about the Z transform, and this will also be covered somewhat in details. Okay. Fourier series, what does it say? So we all know a signal is periodic if for some positive value of t, that means x t equal to x of t plus t for all of t. We have seen that this is the criteria for a signal to be periodic in nature. And we have also seen that for periodic signals, we have two basic periodic signals. One is the sinusoidal signal, it may be either cos or sine signals, okay? And we have another complex exponential signals, e to the power j omega naught t. And we have seen that this e to the power j omega naught t, it is a combination of both cos and sine waves. Okay. Now, when we talk about this Fourier series, what it says is that any periodic signal, it is basically a linear combination of harmonically related complex exponentials of the form this one, right? So this is the basic equation of the Fourier series. Now if you see any periodic signal xt, it is given by with a constant, which is basically a DC component, okay? And then we are having a series of sinusoidal signals which are being added up to which helps us in getting any periodic signal. Okay. So what is the implication of this one? Suppose if you see over here, we are having square wave signals, pulse signals, not square wave. So any pulse wave signal or even the square wave signals, if you see, if you try to synthesize that pulse signal or the square signal, we use sinusoidal signal, and as we go on increasing the number of the sinusoidal signals, we get a curve which is similar to the pulse wave or the square waves. Now the thing is that when we are adding up these sinusoidal signals, what we are doing, we are taking successive successive addition of the harmonics of the basic frequency signal, basic frequency of the signal. Okay, now why we are getting these ripples over here? These ripples are because if you look into the Fourier series component, it varies from k equals to 1 to infinity. But in real sense, we cannot reach the term infinity. So we use only a specified number of harmonics, and because of this, we get this ripples when we are reconstructing it in the practical domain. Similarly, if we have a sawtooth wave, we use the frequencies, we use the sinusoidal waves, and over here, not only the sinusoidal wave of a particular phase, but of different phases, they are used to reconstruct a given signal. Okay, so both the amplitude and the phase, they are important for the reconstruction of a periodic signal. Okay, so Fourier series coefficient, how to get the Fourier series coefficients, I hope every one of you know. Okay, now in the Fourier transform, how it is different from the Fourier series? Fourier series and which are not periodic. How many agree with this statement? He is saying Fourier series are for the periodic signals and Fourier transforms are for the non-periodic or aperiodic signals. So how many of you agree with this statement? And rest of you do not agree. Why? No questions, no answers. The statement is incorrect. Those who have said that Fourier series are for periodic signals and Fourier transform are for aperiodic signals, this statement is incorrect. Okay, the statement is, it lies over here in this assumption. A non-periodic signal may be assumed as a limiting case of a periodic signal. Okay, where the period of the signal approaches infinity, right? So our answer lies over here. Fourier series is for periodic signal, it is totally correct. But when we are talking about the Fourier transform, we are taking an assumption that even the non-periodic signals or aperiodic signals, they are periodic, having a this time period tending to infinity, capital T tending to infinity. Okay, so say for example, if you take the example of a normal sine wave, is it not periodic at capital T tending to infinity? It is periodic, right? If it is periodic within a shorter time, it is expected that it will also be periodic when the capital T or the time period tends to infinity. So the Fourier transform, it applies to both periodic signals and aperiodic signals or non-periodic signals. Okay, please keep this in mind. Many students, they have this misconception that Fourier series is for periodic signals and Fourier transform is for the aperiodic signals. This is not correct. Fourier transform is both for the periodic signals and the aperiodic or the non-periodic signals. Okay, say for example, if you take a sinusoidal wave, if you do the Fourier transform, you will get a peak at a particular frequency. Suppose it is say 50 hertz signal. If you do the Fourier transform, you will get a peak at 50 hertz. If it is 50 hertz, so you will get a peak like this, right? Now, this is the equation for the Fourier transform. X of j omega is equal to integral of minus infinity to infinity x of t e to the power minus j k omega t dt. And our inverse Fourier transform, it is x t equals to 1 by 2 pi integral of minus infinity to infinity x of j omega multiplied by e to the power j omega t d omega. Okay. Now, what does this say? It says that suppose you are having a signal f t or x t, whatever, if you do the Fourier transform of this one, where you apply this equation, you get capital X of omega, okay, f of omega or capital X of omega. That means you are going from time domain signal to the frequency domain signal. Again, if you take this signal and if you apply inverse Fourier transform, which is this equation, you get back to xt. Okay, how does a signal xt looks like? What should be the x axis? Our x axis will be time and y axis is amplitude. So it can be something like this. Okay, and what about x omega? Capital X of omega, x axis is omega and y axis is amplitude. Suppose you are having frequency components made up of 10 hertz, 20 hertz and 30 hertz. So you will be getting peaks at frequencies corresponding to 10 hertz, 20 hertz and 30 hertz. So what it says, you are having a signal like this in the time domain, you apply Fourier transform, we get back we get to this what you call signal, which is a frequency domain signal. Again, from here if we apply inverse Fourier transform, we get back our original signal. Okay, this Fourier transform, it is a conventional transform. It is a conventional transform. Okay, and it has been used since decades to analyze signals, not only for the biomedical signals, but also the electronic signals, then electrical signals, then you talk about this earthquake measurements, seismic measurements. Over there, everywhere it has been used and still it is being used. It is a very simplistic transform and it helps us in analyzing signals in a better way. But there are various other current day transforms which are coming up, which we called as, collectively called as joint time frequency analysis, JTFA. In many textbooks you will find it as TFA, time frequency analysis, and in some books you will find as joint time frequency analysis. I prefer it to say as joint time frequency analysis. Over here, what Fourier transforms tells us that we are taking either the time domain for the analysis or we are taking the frequency domain signal for the analysis. But as we proceed in this subject, we will find that though theoretically it is saying that if we do Fourier transform, we get to the frequency domain, if we apply inverse Fourier transform on the frequency domain signal, we will get back the original signal, but it is not true in all the cases. In many cases you will find it is true, but it is not true in all the cases. So we cannot design a transform which is not applicable for all the signals. Okay, but still saying this, but still Fourier transform, it is one of the simplistic transforms and it is still being currently used in various analyses. Okay. Now, if you look into the non-periodic signal, it is something like this, and if it is a periodic signal formed by the periodic extension of the XT, it may look like this. So, input-output relationship of this thing. So, if you are having XT, you get you give the input to the LTI system, and we have seen that LTI system, it is given by HT, and you get output YT, which is given by the convolution of XT, convolution of HT. Okay, XT convolution of HT. Okay, now convolution is a very tedious task. It is computationally tedious. Okay, so if we are given an option that whether we will go for convolution, convolution is given by this start mark. Okay, in some books you will find that there is a circle across it, and in some book you will just find that it is just this start mark. Okay, so if we are given an option whether we go for convolution or multiplication, usually we prefer multiplication. Now, convolution in the time domain, convolution in the time domain is multiplication in the frequency domain, and vice versa. Vice versa means convolution in the frequency domain is multiplication in the time domain. Okay. So, as we have discussed, that this is the criteria, and we need, we always prefer doing multiplication. So what happens is that what we should do is that if we get apply a Fourier transform on XT, we get X of omega. If we apply Fourier transform on HT, we get H of omega. See over here, it is H of omega, and then we get YT. If we do the Fourier transform over here, basically Y of omega, it is now equals to X of omega multiplied by H of omega. Okay, X of omega multiplied by X of omega. Now, once you get this Y omega, if we apply inverse Fourier transform, you get the same result YT, which is equal to XT convolution of HT. Okay, so the application of this Fourier transform allows us to analyze a signal in a better manner. Now, most of you will say, so what is this HT? This HT, it is called impulse response. Impulse response. Okay. Say, when you are in school, one of your friend, what he did, he just poked you. So due to that poking, if a child is aggressive in nature, he will behave aggressively. Right? But if he is somewhat calm type of child, what he will do? He will be remaining calm most of the time. if this person A is not constantly poking this person, okay? So the similar behavior happens over here also. So what happens is that we give an impulse input, that means we are poking this system, this LTI system, at time n equals to 0. Okay, and we are getting some response. So the response with what we get by giving an impulse input is called impulse response. We call it impulse response. Okay, and now this impulse response, it is represented, because it is again a signal, it is represented with the term HT, and it is the characteristics of a given signal, and it is the characteristic of a given signal. Now next, when you give any unknown signal XT, you know the characteristics of this system, how it will behave, and from there it helps us in calculating YT. Now from here we can calculate this YT by taking into consideration what is this signal input, what we are giving, XT, convolution of H of T. Okay. Now you can understand why this Fourier transform is important for the analysis of the systems, because it makes our life easier to analyze any LTI system. Okay. Now, basically, what happens is that what will be the YT when you give delta T? When you give delta T, H of 0, X of 0, when your XT, if your XT is delta T, what should be your output? It should be H of T. Why? Because your X of T is 1 at n equals to 0, and we get back over here. What is the signal? The signal what you are getting, it is an impulse response. Okay. So if you give an impulse input, you will get an impulse response out of the system. Now Fourier analysis of the discrete time signals, Fourier series representation. See, it is similar to the Fourier series in the analog or the continuous time domain. We have a synthesis equation, we have an analysis equation, and if you look over here, it is the summation of at various levels. Okay. Now coming to the discrete time Fourier transform. Okay, so many of you have studied this signal processing, and you must be knowing about this thing, discrete time Fourier transform and discrete Fourier transform. Can you tell me what is the difference before I start with this? Because most of you have studied, right? What is the difference between discrete time Fourier transform and discrete Fourier transform? No one? Jor sir, in discrete time, discrete Fourier transform, XL, what does that mean? It has no meaning, whatever you are telling. Anyone else? No? Okay. Let's start with this. So, discrete time Fourier transform, as the name suggests, our time domain will be discrete. It will be N and not T. Okay? So, again, from the discrete time Fourier series, we get into the derivation of the discrete time Fourier transform. And this is the equation for the discrete time Fourier transform. x of e to the power j omega summation of n equals to minus infinity to infinity x of n e to the power minus j omega n. And this is the DTFT, inverse discrete time Fourier transform. So 1 by 2 pi summation of 2 pi x of e to the power j omega e to the power j omega n d omega, right? Very good. Is there any problem with this equation? Is there any problem with these equations? Can you see? Equation theek hai. Apart from that, do you find anything? The thing is that if you look into the discrete time Fourier transform, it is discrete in nature. Whereas IDTFT, it is integral. Okay? When you talk about digital systems, it can only take or implement discrete calculations. Can it implement integrals, which is a continuous time variable? Not possible. Okay? Due to this reason, there was a need to have another transform, which is the discrete Fourier transform, which can be used to get the transforms of the signals, both in the frequency and the time domain signals, using the digital systems. And this is where the scientists, they felt the need of discrete Fourier transforms so that they can be implemented in a proper manner in digital systems. So these are there. So I am not going into the details again. The similar principle, you have xn, you have h of n, you get y of n by getting x of n and h of n. And if you give delta n as the input, you get h of n as the output. And again, if you do the discrete time Fourier transform, you get x of omega and DTFT. Again, if you do it in the output section, you get another multiplication, right? It's similar to the previous one for Fourier transform. So I'm not repeating this again over here, okay? The principles are similar. Now coming to the discrete Fourier transform. This is a very good chart which helps us to understand what is happening in discrete Fourier transform. I got it from one of the internet sites, but I forgot the link. So you can just go and search it, you will find. This is a very good chart over here. So what it says is that this is your time domain signal. Okay. Now if you apply your Fourier transform over here, you get the frequency domain signal. Okay. Now for discretizing this signal, time domain signal, what we do? We multiply it. We are multiplying it with an impulse train, delta t. Right? And if we do the Fourier transform of this one, we get this kind of thing. Now we do multiplication in the time domain. You get sampled signal. Okay? And over here, if you see, this is there, you are doing the convolution. So at this position, at this original position, you are getting one impulse which is basically corresponding to the original frequency domain signal. However, due to this impulses in the frequency domain, what you are getting? You are getting some more impulses in the frequency domain when you have discretized this thing. So if you do the Fourier transform, basically the Fourier transform of this sample signal will give you this one, right? And if you do the inverse Fourier transform of this signal, you will get back to this signal. Now if you see the sampling in the time domain, it has resulted in the generation of a spectrum which is repetitive in the frequency domain, which is repetitive in the frequency domain. So in other way, if we do the repetition, if we sample the signal in the frequency domain, we will get repetition in the time domain. Okay, but the thing what we were discussing, if you look over here, this is a sampled signal, but this is a continuous this is a continuous signal in the frequency domain, and we have seen that it is not possible to do this. Okay, now what happens is that if we do not time limit this signal, if we do not time limit the signal, time limit means we just take a portion of the signal, what will happen? What will happen? We all know that while discretizing, we do band limiting. While discretizing, we do band limiting. हम कहाँ पे discretize कर रहे हैं? Where we are discretizing? We are discretizing in the time domain, but we are band limiting in the frequency domain. But we are band limiting in the frequency domain. Why we are doing so? We are trying to limit the frequency component. We are trying to limit the frequency component, right? Similarly, when you have got a continuous signal in the frequency domain and we will be sampling it, because we are not able to process this signal in the digital systems. We are not able to process these signals in the digital systems, right? We have already discussed this. So if we have to sample this one, where we should be doing the limiting? We should be doing the limiting in the time domain. Am I clear? Right? So we apply a time domain this thing. So we do multiplication, right? And after multiplication, over here it is this thing. And for this pulse or rectangular pulse, if you do the FT, we get this function which is called sync function, which we will be discussing later on. Okay, so Fourier transform of this one is a sync function, and if you do the inverse Fourier transform, you get the rectangular this thing. Now if you see over here, this is the sampled signal over here, but we have restricted it within a time period of minus t by 2 to t by 2 and in the frequency domain we still we are having continuous signal. Okay, now after we have time limited, now we are ready to multiply with an impulse train in the frequency domain. Over here we are band limited in the frequency domain and then multiplied the impulse train in the time domain. Now over here, in this case, we have band time limited in the time domain, so we will be multiplying this signal, this impulse train in with the frequency domain signal, and then you get this one, this impulse train. Now when you multiply this thing, you get a sampled frequency domain signal. And similarly over here, what we have seen, when we do the multiplication in the sample the signal in the frequency domain, there is a repetition. Okay, there is a repetition in the other domain. That means there is a repetition in the time domain, right? See, initially we have started with this one, and now there is a repetition over here. Okay, so band limiting helps us in having aliasing of the signal. Similarly, aliasing of the signal in the frequency domain. Time limiting helps us in preventing aliasing in the time domain. In the time domain. Otherwise, what would have happened? Suppose if you have not limited this thing, this signal will be something like this. This would have been like this. Now they are repeating itself, right? So what is this? There is a mixing of the time signal. There is a mixing of the time signals, and due to the mixing of the time signals, what is this? This is nothing but your aliasing. Okay, so when we are doing discrete Fourier transform, we have both time domain signal, it is in the frequency, it is a discrete this thing, and also the frequency this thing, it is discrete. Frequency is also discrete. Time is also discrete. Frequency is also discrete. However, in your discrete time Fourier transform, time was discrete, frequency was continuous. Okay, time was discrete, but frequency was continuous. So have you understood the difference between this, and what is the process of doing this discrete time discrete Fourier transform, right? DFT. Okay. Now there are various phenomena like zero padding, and what does zero padding does? So this we will look into this later on. So this is the discrete Fourier transform equation and IDFT equation, and over here we have used a factor W to the power this kn by n, which is basically e to the power minus j 2 pi n. Okay, this k is separate, n is separate. So if you multiply, if you want to get this xk, basically it will be xk equals to summation of n equals to 0 to n minus 1 x of n into e to the power minus j 2 pi by n into kn. Okay, that's why we are wn is given in this fashion, e to the power minus j 2 pi n multiplied by this kn is over here. Okay, and in case of IDFT, it is minus of kn over here. Okay, any confusion up to this point? Now, many of you say, sir, this equation is very good, so why we want to make the things complex over here like this manner, right? Now this Wn, it is called Tweddle factor. Now what does the Tweddle factor do is that if you look over here, x of k equals to summation of n equals to 0 n minus 1 x of n multiplied by w of minus w of kn, this thing, and in the IDFT 1 by n summation of n minus 1 this thing x of k minus kn by n. Okay, this is done. Now basically what happens is that we will see later on this Wn to the power minus of kn is it can be written as W conjugate n kn. Okay, if you take the conjugate of this one, this will help us in calculating the IDFT. Okay, the process remains the same. So this is the main advantage of DFT. Okay. Now we are having this signal xn, we are having x0, x1, x2, xn like this. The frequency domain signal xk, it is given by x0, x1, and in this manner. See, both this time domain and frequency domain signals are having kya? Same length. हाँ जी बोल साहब, कितना सोओगे? हाँ, मंडे है आज तो एनर्जी होना चाहिए. सो द लेंथ ऑफ बोथ दिस सिग्नल्स दे आर सेम. नाउ दिस इज एन इम्पॉर्टेंट फंडा. सो वी विल लेटर ऑन सी दैट सपोज यू आर हैविंग ए सिग्नल से xn equals to 2, 0. So in this 2, 0, if you get this as the input, you will get a frequency component xk having some values, say capital X1 and capital X2. Sorry, capital X1, capital X2. Okay. Now, I can again write this equation, this thing as 2, 0, 0, 0 as a fourth point thing. Now, what would be the output over here then? X1, X2, X3, X4. Now see, the signal is same, time domain signal is same, right? But we are getting more components in the frequency domain. Okay, you are having more components in the frequency domain. Now take the example that you are having a window like this. Take the example of this window. You can see outside this window. There is no restriction, right? Now, think of a condition. I have blackened this window totally. Okay. Now, what I will do is that now this window, it is totally blackened. You cannot see outside. Now, what happens is that I create a window like this. Now what you are doing? You are looking at the scene but only through this restricted window. Right? Now suppose I create another window over here. This is the second window. This is the first window. This is the second window. So what will happen? Previously you are not able to see anything. Now what has happened? When you have put the first window, you are able to see something. Now when I put the second window, you are having a better observation as compared to the previous instance. Now if I say, if I put another window over here, say the third window, so the you are able to get more and more information about the outside scenery as I am going on increasing the number of the windows. Am I understood? So as you are increasing the number of the windows, we are basically looking at the same scene but with a better resolution. The same thing happens over here also. XN20, you are having the same signal, but in the frequency domain your resolution was restricted. When I have added two more zeros, it is not going to change my original signal. But what I have got? I have got a frequency spectrum with a larger number of points. That means my frequency resolution has increased. In other words, I will be able to look into my frequency spectrum. Now, when I have zero padded the signal, it will give you more information as compared to the non-zero padded signals. Okay? So this phenomena of adding of zeros at the end of the signal, it is called zero padding at the end, because when you add the zeros at the end, they will not change your signal characteristics because the values are zero. But in the frequency domain, what it will do? It will increase your frequency resolution. Okay? It will increase your frequency resolution. But there is a limitation over there. Suppose during the discretization of the original signal, you have not taken proper precaution of band limiting the signal, the signal will be already aliased in the frequency domain. The signal will be aliased in the frequency domain. Right? Now, even after doing the zero padding, you may increase the resolution, but that resolution, increased resolution, will not give you correct picture because the signal is already aliased. So it cannot improve the quality of the aliased signal. Okay? But if it is a non-aliased signal, it can help you in looking into the frequency domain aspect in a better way. Okay? It will help you in understanding the thing in a better way. Okay? So only 5 minutes are left. So I will stop over here. Tomorrow we will look into how to calculate this discrete Fourier transform using this total factor matrix. Okay?